Hello and welcome to Living Truth, a media ministry of the People's Church. Wherever you're tuning in from, we're thrilled that you've decided to join us for our time of worship as we grow in God's Word together. We're so glad that you joined us for week 5 of the Amos series, Minor Prophet, Major Issues. Let's join in now to hear what God has put on Pastor Brett's heart to share with us.
Church, please turn in your Bibles to Amos chapter 5. One of the most important books in Scripture is actually the book of Lamentations. It is structured in such a way that it is an acrostic that repeats 5 times over. The A to Z of the Hebrew alphabet frames that book. And what it reveals to us is that the full weight of sin is to be lamented. That we are allowed to express our grief and our sorrow, the fullness of it. We're not to try and rush through the sorrow that we're experiencing. We're to allow it to be fully expressed. And that we're to drink of our lament right down to the dregs. The fullness of it has to run its course. That's important for us to be reminded of today because Amos chapter 5 is actually a lament. It's him expressing the sorrow of what he sees in the culture around him. Amos's name means burden bearer. And he's grieving the condition of man in the northern tribes. And when we go through grief, we go through a range of emotions. We go through shock, denial, depression, or sorrow, or despair, bargaining sometimes, or anger, or acceptance, where that's just the way it is. And when you study the book of Amos, you see him grieving throughout the book, lamenting the condition of the northern tribes. And he opens chapter 5 with that very idea. Look at what he says in verse 1. Hear this word, Israel. This lament I take up concerning you. Fallen is virgin Israel, never to rise again, deserted in her own land with no one to lift her up. This is what the sovereign Lord says to Israel. Your city that marches out 1,000 strong will have only 100 left. Your town that marches out 100 strong will only have 10 left. We're told in Philippians 3 that Paul describes the fellowship of sharing in the sufferings of Christ. Part of that suffering that we experience as believers is the grief, the sorrow of what's happening in the world around us. It's a participation with Christ, where the burden of lament and what we see around us actually bows us on our knees in prayer that people would be open to God's redemptive activity in their lives. And Amos turns his attention to that amongst the culture. Look at what he says in the next verse. This is what the Lord says to Israel. Seek me and live. Do not seek Bethel. Do not go to Gilgal. Do not journey to Beersheba, for Gilgal will surely go into exile, and Bethel will be reduced to nothing. Seek the Lord and live, or he will sweep through the tribes of Joseph like a fire. It will devour them, and Bethel will have no one to quench it. Now, these locations he's just listed are deeply theological and historical places that the northern tribes worshiped at. Bethel was the heart of Israel's worship center where Jeroboam I, when he took over the kingdom, established one of the golden calves for worship. Gilgal was the location of the Joshua and the army coming into the promised land, one of the first camps where he prepared the army. And Beersheba, which was located in the south, was a pilgrimage site where they would go and worship because of the significance in the life of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But all three of these locations represented infidelity in their worship because they didn't worship him where his name dwelt at the temple in Jerusalem. They were worshiping the past activity of God and missing out on the present reality of his work in front of them. They were metaphorically worshiping yesterday's manna that was not meant to be held on to. And it reminds us that we can actually get stuck in the past or the traditions of man and miss out on the present activity of God right in front of us. We can go through the forms of worship, the motions of worship, but actually be missing out on the fullness, worshiping someone else's relationship with God. That's actually what happened to the Pharisees in the New Testament. They were so busy worshiping the texts and the Torah and the traditions of Moses that they missed out on the Messiah who's standing right in front of them. And Amos calls out to his generation and he says, "Seek me and live. Seek the Lord, seek Yahweh and live." And then he laments their condition. In verses 8 through 9, God reminds them who he is. "I'm the one who makes light in the darkness. I'm the one who makes water come from the seas and fertile your land." But in their worship, they were neglecting God. They had exchanged the truth of who God is for a lie. And in Romans chapter 1, we get a robust description of what happens when we do that. When we exchange the truth of God for a lie, we end up worshiping created things. We bow down to idols of our own making, and that's what was happening in the northern tribes, but it doesn't stop there. It actually shows up in how we treat one another. It ends up in the commodification of humanity and oppression and injustice, and that's what was happening in the northern tribes. Amos outlines their sin beginning in verse 7. Look at what he says. "There are those who turn justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground." He continues in verse 10. "There are those who hate the one who upholds justice in court and detest the one who tells the truth. You levy a straw tax on the poor and impose a tax on their grain. Therefore, though you have built stone mansions, you will not live in them. Though you have planted lush vineyards, you will not drink their wine. For I know how many are your offenses and how great your sins. There are those who oppress the innocent and take bribes and deprive the poor of justice in the courts. Therefore, the prudent keep quiet in such times, for the times are evil." There comes a moment where injustice is so baked into the system, even into the courts, even into the taxation of citizens, that those who are righteous, those who are prudent, stay silent because they would be speaking up to their own peril. This is what happens when there's a failed state. You don't speak out because it's just going to get you killed. The whole system is rigged. It's a pyramid scheme. Those at the top who have all the power are crushing those at the bottom who are poor and innocent. This is what was happening in the northern tribes. I mean, we see that reality. Amos is on his knees, grieving, lamenting the injustice of society. You see, the danger is when we drift in our fidelity and worship to Yahweh and neglect his commands, we can actually, because we are deceived, because we are sinful, we can redefine good and evil in order to justify why it's okay to harm or oppress or subdue others. Amen? Amen? Amen. Y'all don't seem to believe it. What makes us able to do this to other human beings? Well, it's simply put, sin. Amos is lamenting this, the sin that has taken hold of their worship, but has also become systemic in nature, woven into the courts, woven into the laws, and it's crushing the needy. And Amos again tells them what their response should be with tears in his eyes. Look at verse 14. Seek good, not evil, that you may live. Then the Lord God Almighty will be with you just as you say he is. Hate evil, love good, maintain justice in the courts. Perhaps the Lord God Almighty will have mercy on the remnant of Joseph. Think of what Amos is saying to the culture around him with tears in his eyes. Seek me and live. Seek the Lord Yahweh and live. Seek good, not evil. Hate evil. Love good. Love righteousness. You see, the problem with embracing evil and when it becomes systemic in nature is it always, only, and forever ends in bitterness, anguish, and lament. And Scripture bears witness to that. Look at verse 16. Therefore, this is what the Lord God Almighty says, there will be wailing in all the streets and cries of anguish in every public square. The farmers will be summoned to weep and the mourners to wail. There will be wailing in all the vineyards, for I will pass through your midst, says the Lord. The whole chapter of Amos is lament, weeping in advance of where this is all headed. The exile of the people of God out of the Holy Land. Okay, we're going to step out of Amos now into church history. And it's fitting that Amos chapter 5 is a book of lament, grieving the system that was rigged and turned justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground, because evil and injustice had become systematized. They were woven into the courts and the laws of the land, and it was crushing people who were created in the image and likeness of God. Now, I'm going to suspend time for the rest of our service. Some of what we need to look at is really important. It's going to take some time. But it's important for us to understand this. And I got to tell you, this week was like drinking poison for me. Looking at the ugliness of the transatlantic slave trade and all the destruction that it has created, and every single one of us has been impacted by this. But let's see how. A few weeks ago, we looked at how while Spain was discovering the Americas, and predominantly South America, and subduing its citizens, reading out the requirement, we also looked a few weeks ago at how Portugal had been authorized by the Pope to look for trade routes along the western coast of Africa, trying to get to India and China for silks and spices and trade. Because the land-based routes, because of the Crusades and the fall of the Ottoman Empire, had been compromised. And we looked a few weeks ago at how hundreds of years of Crusades and wartime theology were informing the policies and practices of the church and the popes. And we looked at how sometimes our warped theology strongholds are ideas that start out as theologies or spiritual ideas, but start to take on physical manifestations. And one of those we looked at a few weeks ago was Elmina Castle. Now, this castle stands to this day. As Portugal went along the western coast, they started to establish fortresses so that they could trade in the area. Increasingly, they moved from ivory and gold to trading for humans and enslaved humans. Now, let me just give you a few examples of how the theological expression to justify enslavement and oppression took form. Some pointed to the Old Testament, to the time of Noah, and it's referred to as the curse of Ham. Not Ham, the food we eat, but Ham, the second son of Noah. These were some of the theologies that were floating around within the church during the period of enslavement. But the one that I just, like, those are alarming already. But the one that I really struggle with is in 1791, Haitians revolted against their oppressors and won their freedom and secured their liberty. And because of the Haitian revolt, other islands in the Caribbean and other parts of the colonies got worried that this would spread. And so they started to limit the teaching of Scripture, because Scripture speaks much about oppression and injustice and righteousness. And so what you have commissioned in 1791 after the slave revolt is what is referred to now as the Slave Bible, or the Negro Bible, pardon my English. This is where they edited the Scriptures and chose what slaves could be educated on from Scripture. Now, the Bible that you have in the pews in front of you, or that you're holding in your hand, the Protestant Bible, has 1,189 chapters of Scripture. The Slave Bible has 232 chapters. Anything that speaks of injustice or righteousness or throwing off and being delivered from oppression has been removed. And like in Amos chapter 5, when you see some of these theologies spreading in different parts of the church, different actions of those who claim faith, Amos chapter 5, verse 7 is the only response. There are those who turn justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground. Now, let me just continue for a moment beyond the time of slavery into this scientific trend line that has been started by Linnaeus, by Long, and continues into 1837 when Charles Darwin travels around the world documenting systems of nature and writes Origin of the Species, and begins to argue that all of animal life has evolved over millions of years to adapt to its environment through biological changes, the survival of the fittest, and adaptation and evolution is how animal life has progressed. That the earth is much older, and through evolutionary development, mankind has arrived at a progressive state. And that survival of the fittest has enabled man to dominate. And so for some people, that just becomes a greater scientific argument that it's okay to dominate others and oppress others because survival of the fittest, it's just science. We're at the top of a hierarchy, of a chain. We've progressed. And what you have forming over a century is a system of racial identification, differentiation, and classification that has moved so far away from Scripture that also has the danger of throwing off any moral restraint, because while some people threw off the Bible or the church altogether, others just went, you know what, we don't even need God, we are God. We're at the top. And that's what awakened the world to the train tracks that they were riding on. So what you see in this period of history is in the church warped theology attempting to justify sin and oppression. But what you see in the culture is warped philosophy and junk science to justify sin and oppression. Here's the problem with all of it. There is only one race, the human race, made in the image and likeness of God. Sure, the Bible talks about many ethnicities. The Bible talks about many ethnicities and cultural heritages that we bring into our faith. The Bible includes those distinctions, but there is only one race of man, one species, the human race. Race and racism is a social construct fashioned during a time of oppression and unjust othering of humanity. But you have to understand, it was a multidisciplinary, theological, philosophical, pseudoscientific institution taught in academies and universities. And it has influenced our lives today. To a world architecting a system of hierarchy and othering human beings, Amos says, there are those who turn justice into bitterness and cast righteousness to the ground. And while all this was happening in the schools of thought and science, making its way into the church's theology, you had laws that were unjust being written into the policies and practices of newfound nations. Martin Luther King Jr. authored a book entitled The Measure of a Man. In the book, he is arguing that the black man is actually a man, not some other species. And he's doing that because he knew that if he could convince the culture around him that the black man is actually a man, then he would be protected by the Constitution. All men are created equal. Think of that. And here's kind of the reality you have. You have one group of people writing the slave Bible, editing the slave Bible. You have another arguing, this is wrong. We need to end this evil. And eventually, the abolitionist movement overcame the injustice. And slave transportation in Britain was outlawed in 1807. Slave ownership in 1834, anywhere in Britain or its colonies. And in 1865 in the United States of America. But here's the only problem. The multidisciplinary architecture of race and racism, the pseudo-scientific classification and othering and dividing up of humanity lived on. And racism persisted. It morphed into Jim Crow laws, atrocious systems of injustice that continued to cast righteousness to the ground. Let me close with this thought. The moment we differentiate and degrade other fellow human beings, it is not God we are worshiping. There is only one race, the human race, created in the image and likeness of God, sacred to him. And to a world warped by this idea, God says, seek me and live. Seek the Lord and live. Seek good, not evil. Hate evil, love good. And right in the middle of his book, Amos is overwhelmed with grief and sorrow and lament at what he's seeing in his world. And we need to allow the grief, the lament to wash over us. We might be grieving in different forms this morning, but we all go to the same place with that grief. We go to meet Jesus at the cross because we remember that he knows what it is to suffer injustice, to see righteousness cast to the ground, to drink the cup of bitterness. He knows what it is to have the whip on his back and to be oppressed and suffering violence, dying a wrongful death. He's not distant from us in our grief, in our sorrow. So we're going to close with a song that's going to be sung over us this morning. And I invite you just sit in this moment in light of what we've heard and process the rightful lament that we should have in our hearts because of what's been done, because every single one of us has been affected by this. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for this chapter of lament. And Lord, we acknowledge that this isn't just something out there. It's something in us. This othering of humanity, this callous indifference or complacency with what is broken around us. Lord, forgive us for the times that we just turn a blind eye or a deaf ear to it. And Lord, would you by your grace allow us to drink the cup of lament this morning, to let it be fully expressed in us in this time of worship. We thank you that you died on the cross for it. Meet us in this time now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's worship together.
thank you so much for being here. We hope that you've gained a deeper desire to see Jesus through the Word this week. You can visit livingtruth.ca for resources like our daily devotionals and past sermons. We look forward to growing more with you very soon.